in order to get rid of me and you and promote equality, they have to attack us because of our differences in opinion. That's what separates constitutional law and constitutional governments from socialist governments. As long as you agree with what the socialists believe in, then you're fine. But if you go against the grain, you are attacked. In 1898, Masaryk began to discuss imminent contradictions between capitalism and socialism. In 1903, he described Russian religious intellectuals and its society as a whole as Byzantine retardation of the Russians by the Orthodox Church combined with reactionary ideas. Another form of subversion. Attack religions, attack belief systems, attack sovereignty. That's what they do, your sovereignty. Okay, they want to take away that and promote equality. Then they want to take away your belief systems. They want to take away what you feel is right. And you know, I have my issues when it comes to God, but I respect people who believe in God. Nobody should take that away from them. When somebody goes and they try to do that, then that's on them. Pointing out the differences between capitalism and socialism, that is just complete craziness. Okay, you want to compare a Marxist to what, an elite? So what's the point? It creates chaos. People don't do anything constructive whenever you have these kind of discussions. In 1915, Tomas Masaryk made his way to the West after the beginning of the First World War. He was recognized as the leader of the underground Czech liberation movement. With help from his French and English friends, Masaryk established contact with Allied leaders. He made clear what the Czechs' aims were: restitution of Bohemia's independence, establishment of a Czech Slavic unity, dismemberment of Austria-Hungary, and establishing a new states between Russia and Germany. Okay, Masaryk's view was that German imperialism was an infected spot in which a line had to be drawn around and isolated. After the overthrow of the autocratic czarist regime in 1900, In 17, Tomas Masaryk redirected his actions toward Russia. His new objectives were to reorganize Czechoslovak Legion while developing new contacts with the newly formed government. After the Bolshevik Revolution, Masaryk set out for the United States, negotiating terms for Czechoslovak independence with President Woodrow Wilson and Robert Lansing. In 1918, Czechoslovakia was recognized as an Allied power. Within the same year, Tomas Masaryk was elected the first president of Czechoslovakia. So, Woodrow Wilson was the president that I was mentioning, the person who really pushed for the socialist movement in the beginning here in the United States. He actually had the audacity to go to Europe, and he came up with the concept of the League of Nations. He was actually the big supporter and organizer behind that, and he started promising all these countries that the United States was going to join. He came back to the United States after making all these promises, and he was point blank told, "You didn't have the authority to do that." A lot of people were pretty much offended by it because he wasn't wanting to recognize the sovereignty of our country or our right to make the decision on if we wanted to join the League of Nations. And the United States never officially joined the League of Nations. Woodrow Wilson actually toured around the United States to push the agenda after making the mistake, but it fell through. Just like the League of Nations fell through too. And all of that was because we had a president that went overseas and made promises that he didn't have the authority to make. And see, back then, our people in our country actually knew what they were doing, and they stood up against the president, and that was it. Today, look at the things that are going on, and we're just allowing it to happen. Right there, I introduced one player that in the whole development of socialism that was taking place in Europe. We had Bloom in France, and then once I finished talking about Bloom, I started talking about Czechoslovakia. Czechoslovakia was very important in all of this. The person that was really pushing hard on Austria-German issue, which it should have been done. I mean, it was a threat, but he also was pushing that and insulting Russia, insulting his own people, being very subverted towards his own sovereignty. And the reason why he was doing it is because he was trying to establish a socialist government. Karl Renner became a member of the moderate wing of the Social Democratic Party in 1907. After the collapse of the Habsburg monarchy in 1918, being a deputy in the Reichsrat, he also became the first chancellor to the new Austrian Republic. During his term, he proved unable to prevent sizable territorial losses to Italy, Czechoslovakia, and Yugoslavia. In 1919, though, Renner signed the Treaty of Saint-Germain, which further prevented Austria's union with Germany, a project he had initially supported. Karl Renner advocated Austrian entry into the League of Nations, a policy of fulfillment of treaty obligations, and strict neutrality in foreign affairs. The leader of the Socialist Democratic Party in the 1920s, he became president of the Nationalrat, lower house of parliament, from 1930 until 1933. In 1938, he supported Nazi annexation of Austria. After 1945, Renner worked with the Soviet Union to reconstitute an Austrian government. He formed a provisional regime and became chancellor of the reborn Austria. Later, the same year, Renner was also unanimously elected president of the republic. First, we had Tomas Masaryk, who opposed the Nazis and the Austrian annexation of Germany, who was a socialist in the socialist parties of Czechoslovakia. Then we have Karl Renner now, who is also a part of the Socialist Democratic Party in Austria. And he supported the Nazi regime in the Austrian annexation into Germany. He also was a member of the League of Nations. Now, this goes back to what I was mentioning before about this fallacy that people have, I don't know if it's been pushed on them in history or if it's just people's natural way of thinking, that the Nazis were not socialist and that the Nazis were against socialism. Evidence in history, if you look at it, proves that that is just a false statement, and it is not true. The Nazis were socialists. They were socialists who used monopolies to create fascism. I'll press that. Here's another little bit of proof to prove what I'm trying to say with Karl Renner. Karl Renner supported the Nazi regime. After the war, he ended up reconstituting Austria for the Soviet Union, the communism. So he went from being a socialist to a Nazi to a communist. I don't think so. I don't think that his beliefs ever changed. It was a socialist belief, and all three fit into the same category. They are not different. People keep coming up with these statements that just aren't true historically. And I personally blame it on the education. Said most college students give up on history the moment they get into college. Once they get into college, they don't want to do it anymore. You know, you don't hear about Karl Renner in any of the world history, but they'll try to push it on time that Czechoslovakia was taken during the Cold War by the Soviet Union. No, it didn't happen that way. Czechoslovakia went voluntary. They had no problem with being a member of the Soviet Union whatsoever. They were a socialist government ran by a socialist president. Ignaz Seipel was a Roman Catholic priest and twice Chancellor of Austria from 1922 until 1929. His use of the fascist parliamentary Heim War against Austrians Social Democrats led to the strengthening of fascism in Austria. After the collapse of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, Ignaz Seipel was the leader of the Christian Social Party. He was able to prevent the Christian Social Party from splitting up into monarchist and republican elements. In 1922, Ignaz Seipel formed his first government, a coalition with the Greater Germany Party. He then obtained a loan from the League of Nations for $100 million. Now, Seipel was able to do this in exchange for financial and administrative reforms. These were to be carried out with the Allied supervision of Alfred Zimmermann, Dutch commissioner of the League of Nations. Wounded in an assassination attempt in 1924, Ignaz resigned the following November, even though he was able to curb deflation. His efforts met with hostility from provincial governments and his own party. During a second term from 1926 until 1929, Seipel was able to obtain a majority in parliament. His use of the parliament Heim War against the Austrian socialists in 1927 foreshadowed the events of what happened in 1934 when his disciple Egbert Dollfuss destroyed Austrian democracy and replaced it with a clerical fascist dictatorship. Towards the end, Ignaz Seipel became a more authoritarian advocate of a corporate state with strong presidential powers. Finally, after serving as foreign minister in 1930, Seipel resigned in ill health and died 2 years later.